Hey there, product launchers. I have a great new expert to introduce you to today. I've got Joe Tarnowski from ECRM and RangeMe. And Joe has, you know, a lot of experience. There's a lot of people on this platform that there's a lot of our experts have tons of experience, and Joe's one of them. So we're going to find out how he got that experience. We're going to find out what ECRM stands for, because I can never remember. I know what they do, but I can never remember what it stands for. But the real point that I want you to get out today is that Joe is here because he has loads of experience across multiple product categories, watching companies present to buyers, watching things happen in the industry in a way that he's got this really unique perch of seeing what goes right and what goes wrong. So that's where he's here to protect you from those hazards of product launching, the other hazards, of course. And so, hey, Joe, welcome.
Thank you. Thanks for inviting me.
We're so glad to have you as an expert here. And really, I just want to get started because I realized this morning as I was preparing for our call that we've been on our flash topic on Tim Bush's podcast, On the Shelf. We've been doing that, I don't know, maybe 6 months or something like that.
Yeah.
And I don't know your story. Like, I don't know how you got started in the industry. Like, I know what an expert you are, but we dive in and we just get talking about stuff that I forget that we weren't personally acquainted before that.
That's right. Actually, the first podcast that I did with him is when I gave my background. And I can start from the beginning. I mean, basically my background is in trade media journalism. So I've been covering retail and food service prior to coming on board at ECRM for about 24 years. And so we're talking, food service retail on a magazine called Food Service Director. Then grocery retail with Progressive Grocer. I was with them for about 14 years. I was also written for Convenience Store News, the Gourmet Retailer. So a lot of food retail. And even now in my role on ECRM, I still dabble a little bit and do some more writing for the trades, including Drugstore News, Chain Drug Review, MMR. I like to keep my hand in the game. This way they trust me as a marketer.
Well, so now that explains even more why you're here to compliment the skills, because I always joke about this, but I don't do food and fashion. And so I've done every product category under the sun, and I have done like fashion accessories because I have a textile background, but I don't do food and fashion because you have like taste, speed to market, FDA involvement, like there's a whole bunch of stuff. So you've got a broad range of experience that complements that. I love it. Great.
Yeah, I don't do the fashion, but I definitely went deep in food. And kind of that's a segue into what I'm doing now, because since over the years, you know, the product categories that I've covered have been food, general merchandise, health and beauty care, pharmacy. So, you know, when I came on board with ECRM, those are the specific areas that they cover. So if you like, I can give you a quick 2-minute overview.
Well, tell us what ECRM stands for.
Okay. All right. Well, the name is old. You know, it's just about a 25-year-old company. And ECRM officially stands for Efficient Collaborative Retail Marketing.
That's been the name all along?
That's been the name for the past, I think, 10 years or so. It was something else previously. I don't remember what it was.
Did it have something with like Market Gate in it or something like that?
Well, the website platform for ECRM is Market Gate.
Right.
So, but there's been a couple of other iterations of the name in the past. I think it was something with the efficient consumer or category management. I don't remember what it was.
But well, collaborative marketing is exactly what we're here to do. So you guys fit in perfectly with that.
Yep. And most of the categories that they cover are categories that I have reported on over the past 25 years. So basically what ECRM does in a nutshell is we help retail buyers and food service operators to discover new products and help plan their categories. And we do that in a few ways. And on the flip side of that, obviously, is the supplier side, where we help connect these suppliers with these retailers and food service operators.
And by suppliers, they mean you, product launchers, people with product brands, right?
Mostly, I'd say 95% new and emerging products. They're not in retail yet. Maybe most of them are just on Amazon or they're selling online. So they're looking to get on the shelves of retail chains, on the shelf, kind of like Tim's podcast. And so that's what we do, is we help make those connections. And, you know, we do it in a deep way. So And on a basic level, we have our more than 60 category focused sessions. And that's where we will bring together all of these suppliers and all of these retail category buyers, and we will have private pre-scheduled meetings. So this is a very basic level. It gets a lot deeper than that. I'm not going to go too much into the details.
So the only thing I want to touch on and is that the service that you guys provide from a buyer's perspective is mm-hmm. amazing. So I was a buyer. It was in a contract furniture industry, but uh-huh. I was a buyer there. And the inundation you have, and this is, you know, early email that I'm talking about when I was acting as a buyer, and the inundation with emails and solicitations and all of this is something that is so overwhelming to these retail buyers that they can't possibly vet them, source them, or take all the time. And so ECRM is providing that sort of kind of middle ground and conduit to that so that they have, they understand who's qualified, who would fit their model before they ever take the meeting. So it the time saving for a buyer is huge, but the quality that they do in terms of qualifying is amazing as well. So just be thinking about this. This is not like they're in your way, that they're not. That's why I don't love market gate, because it's not a gate.
Nope.
But it's really sort of understanding, are you ready yet? Are you there yet? And ECRM is providing that buyer side saying, you should meet with these people, right? Like, they are ready. They are the right kind for you. And so that's an invaluable resource, because there's just not enough time in the day for most buyers to get to yes. all their emails.
In fact, that is really, really what we provide is efficiency, effectiveness, and relevance. More than everything is we make sure that we're vetting everybody, and we're only putting the relevant suppliers in front of these buyers. And the thing is, outside of our core sessions, right? So we have 60 sessions, they're category based, divided up into four or five divisions. So we'll have grocery, you know, so things like candy, snacks, beverages, you know, we'll also have food service, so campus food service, commercial, non-commercial food service, and retail food service. Then we'll have general merchandise, which is part of your bread and butter. Yep. So then we'll have sessions like pet, toy, housewares, household, consumer technology. Then we'll also have health and beauty care, and that spans a lot of categories. So we'll have skincare, hair care, cosmetics, vitamins and supplements, OTC. And then finally, we have pharmacy and medical markets. And so we'll cover specialty pharmacy, diabetes, pharmacy technology. So across all of those, so we will connect the buyers and sellers, but it really goes beyond that, where, like you mentioned, we're taking a lot of the busy work off of the retailer's hands. And, you know, because the process starts well in advance of the in-person sessions. So we will work with the supplier, with the buyers. When a buyer signs up, they'll let us know what their focus is. They'll let us know the subcategories that they're interested in, any particular certifications. And what we'll do is, based on that, we will match them up with the suppliers who, on their end, when they register, they're indicating which, you know, categories and subcategories they tick off.
And this is the number one thing. When you're a new brand, this is an invaluable resource, because you don't know what you don't know. That's why you're here on Product Launch Hazards, likely, because you do realize that you don't know a whole ton of stuff. And one of the things that you don't know is all the information that a buyer wants to know about you. And so it's that information that might be missing that you just didn't know you needed, like a certification is required. Mm-hmm. You could have gotten before that meeting, and now you're ruled out and you're done. Yep. And you could have been prepared for that. And that's something that, because you know ahead of time, because they're filling out this very, very detailed profile and all the information and all the boxes get checked.
Yep.
And so that's really different. So that's part of why you guys bought or merged with RangeMe, is that I don't know what the right term for that is.
You just read my mind, because that was going to be my segue. So yes, so we acquired RangeMe last year. Actually, it's almost exactly a year ago. And because of that, RangeMe is a product discovery platform that captures a lot. Again, they have thousands of buyers from major retail chains using the platform, and they gather, and they have 125,000 suppliers. And again, mostly, primarily new and emerging brands across all of those categories that we already are working with on ECRM. So what's really cool is the platform though is amazing. It's very slick. It captures all of that information so that when the buyer looks at a supplier profile, all of that information is right there. So what we're, and the other thing, the other advantage that Rangebee has is Rangebee is very deeply connected with buyers. They are the inbound product discovery platform for about 50 major retail chains. So in other words, if you go to Target's website and you click on a link for vendors to submit products, Rangebee handles the entire back end of all the inbound product submissions. So for them, for Albertsons, for Whole Foods, for CVS, for a lot of major retailers, so all of their buyers are on the platform. And what happens is if suppliers submit through those links, it's routed to the appropriate buyer at the appropriate retailer.
It's like, alert, there's something new and innovative in your, that meets your criteria, right? It's kind of a matching service, right?
Yep. So again, it eliminates all of those things you talked about. All of the, you know, they don't have to worry about the phone calls. They don't have to worry about the emails. They don't have to worry about, you know, we'll even give them a card, a business card that they could take to trade shows. So if they meet with somebody, they could just give them the card that says rangebee.com/target. And it doesn't give out their information. So that this way they upload their product information through the platform.
Yeah, so that's an insider secret you may not know, product launchers, that buyers' emails are hidden. Like, they keep them very, very, very close. A lot of times, I mean, you know, people get smart and think that they can defeat the system by figuring out what the emails are. But I know a lot of companies that have their buyer emails are slightly different than the company standard for just that reason. And if you ended up emailing that address, it ends up at some assistant's desk somewhere into basically a black hole. Yeah. So because otherwise they would never get their work done.
No, and that's the thing. Time is such a premium with them. And so that's what we do. Like you said, you know, we really help them get the most of their time investment because they can't be out of the office for too long. So we'll do that. And we'll do it in other ways too. Aside from those 60 plus category based sessions, we will do more custom related sessions for some of these larger retailers. We call them, this is a new name for them, but efficient strategic summits. So a good example is, and this is where the integration of Rangebee is really coming into play, because a good example is we just did with Wakefern an own brand summit. And we used, what we did was we put the word out, you know, I made some content around it. We put press releases out in the trade media. We sent email blasts to all of our databases and the Rangebee list, inviting suppliers that qualify to submit their application to participate. And then what happened was they had to apply through the Rangebee platform. We had a custom link. Then once they applied, the products were routed to the correct buyers at Wakefern. And then they vetted them based on, you know, whether it was something that they wanted. So we had 1,000 people apply. And then once they narrowed it down, there were 250 suppliers that were invited to a custom session that was held near the Wakefern offices, where they had about 26 buyers participate.
So and that's an amazing opportunity, because it's like, you know, a lot of times you're out there submitting your toy, your game, your furniture, whatever it might be, right? And you're out there doing that and you have no idea if someone's interested or open to buy, as the term goes in the industry, right? But here they're asking you to set up the summit. So they're clearly interested in finding new and innovative products within this category under this criteria. So being able to participate, 250 sounds like a lot of people to compete with, but it's 250 who are very focused with an opportunity to really get bought. Yeah, and that's huge.
Yeah. And the thing is we, you know, we help eliminate all the busy work in getting that done, you know, from the point of putting the word out there. You know, we run, I think, 6 trade publications, as well as our website, LinkedIn, and all that. But then, you know, vetting, you know, bringing everything into the system so they can basically just vet everything really on the platform. And it's, like I said, it's very slick. It's really, you know, really, really easy to navigate. And then, you know, at the physical meetings themselves, we manage that for them. So they just show up and it's really close to their offices. So we just schedule it so that the buyers can come in, meet with their, and then go back. So it's all about efficiency. It's part of, you know, they're looking to grow their own brand's business. we've done this, we do this with a lot of different retailers throughout the year. We've done a diversity summit, a supplier diversity summit with Walgreens last year. I mean, these are all public knowledge. We've talked about these in the trades, and, you know, but right. That's one of the ways that we're working ECRM and RangeMe together, where RangeMe more and more is becoming the platform where the retailers, whether they're at these summits or at our sessions, to kind of vet these products and suppliers who they're going to be meeting with.
That's fantastic. So one of the things is that we interviewed, it's Nikki Jackson, is that right?
Nikki Jackson, yes.
Yeah, Nikki Jackson, who invented RangeMe. She's the founder of it and everything. And she came out of the world of working in consumer products goods in the beauty industry. And so there's a whole story about it. I'll make sure we link it in the post so you guys can read it. But I did both a podcast interview with them and an Inc. article. And so we'll link both of those in. But what I found was so interesting is she had both perspectives. So she went out in the world wanting to do her own beauty products, right? And then found out how she was an insider and she couldn't even get a meeting. And so she said, this is ridiculous because there's a list of things I didn't know if I wasn't going to present to my own company, which is the only company I knew. And so that's really where RangeMe came about. And so I loved the thought that she came from both sides of the viewpoint to understanding like what's valuable for the buyer side and what's valuable for the product and brand side and how you can bring those two together so that it's much more efficient at the end of the day for both sides and much better fit because, you know, getting on a shelf is a risky thing, right? It's risky for you because you might have, as a product brand, because you might have a lot of inventory invested in that. And what if it doesn't work because it's just not a good fit? Mm-hmm. And because they didn't ask the questions of you and you didn't ask the questions of them. So that can be problematic. And of course, it's very risky on the buyer side because they can't afford to not be turning inventory at the rate at which they need to keep their job. So, you know, so you
We're all about that. We, like you mentioned before, that relevance, you know, and it even gets into like the ECRM MarketGate platform is a custom built platform and it's evolved over the 24 years that we've been around. Like, here's an example. When a buyer is going through the list of suppliers with one of our account managers, right? The other thing about ECRM is we're incredibly high touch. So everybody who registers is assigned an account manager, walks them through their schedules a couple of times as it gets closer to the session to make sure that it's relevant. And for example, we've built in things like if, let's say, a buyer is looking for prestige beauty, and sees that the initial pass of matches is one of the suppliers is a value supplier, known for value products. So then the buyer would say, no, I don't want to meet with this person because they have a value, you know, and we're looking for prestige. Well, they have an opportunity. Let's say that value supplier came out with a new line of prestige products that they don't, the retailer doesn't know about. Well, they can rebut through our system and say, look, I know you know we're a value retailer, a value supplier, but we just launched this new line of prestige products you might be interested in. And then they could say, well, you know what, on second thought, I will meet with, you know. So there's, it's so tailored to make sure that when they get together in person, that that time is well spent, both on the supplier side and on the buyer side.
So let's talk about some of these events that you run, because I think that that's really also critical. So I'm not going to... They're way more, I hate to call them a trade show. Like, it doesn't fit what they are at all. Like, it's way more than a trade show. But you have educational platforms for both sides involved in every single event that you guys run. And you run events pretty much every other month or every month, if I'm not wrong.
And put it this way, in February, I think we have 22.
Wow.
We schedule them according to when the major buyers are doing their planning. Mm-hmm. So sometimes they lump together in ways that are just, you know, so February, I'm looking at my calendar now. February has got like 22. There's like 12 in April, a handful in June. Well, you know, so it, depending on the buyer's schedule.
October's big, I bet.
No, October's actually not as big. The beginning, they tend, the first half of the year is really heavy, and then the summer. And then,
you know why October's big on my end? Because that's usually when we do all the supplier audits in Asia or the factory audits in Asia. Oh, okay. So I bet that's when they all decide to travel to Asia.
Yeah, it slows down because you're getting to the holiday sales season. So, but the one thing that it's funny you mentioned trade show, that we're not a trade show. we've really repositioned ourselves against that. And Tim will be the first to tell you, because
he will. I know.
With him, as far as like, well, they're not events; they're sessions, because it's not just sure. The in-person meeting is just the part of it that the people see, but there's so much planning and stuff that goes on in the front end and then the follow-up side that we're really just an extension of the retailer's planning and category planning and product discovery efforts. So we try to, you know, we try to eliminate trade show or event from all of our marketing, all of our, you know, content. But you know, there are a lot of educational opportunities that we do. I'm involved with a lot of them because I used to set them up when I was with the trade media, you know, so we'll bring in a lot of speakers. You know, we usually have at least one or two educational sessions at each of these. Sometimes it's market research companies like Nielsen or IRI or NPD or Mintel, you know, we'll have them talk about trends based on their data. We may also have industry experts, you know, such as Tim came in and spoke about specifically about selling. We may have customers come in and do, I love doing retailer panel discussions. Mm-hmm. You know, get a few retailers on the panel and have them talk about trends that they're seeing and how it's impacting their businesses. You know, we like to do different types of things. We'll try to do, you know, we want to make each of our sessions a place where people are there to engage with each other. So sure, you have the meetings themselves, and the meetings are a learning experience. And this is probably one thing I'll do one of these sessions on is, you know, one thing that I always say is for suppliers, especially from every meeting with a buyer, you should come away with something, whether it's a follow-up that could lead to a sale or information that's going to improve their business. One of those things, you should get at least one of those things from every single meeting. And there's
it's sort of that model that a no is actually a good result, right?
Exactly,
it's like,
yeah.
Learn something that you didn't have, and now next time you're going to be even more focused in who you approach.
And you knock it out of the park at your next year's meeting with them.
Yeah.
So, and that's the thing, retailers would say, I'd rather have them take my feedback, work it into their products, and then come and hit a grand slam the next year. And then, so it's an ongoing thing, but we also provide opportunities, lots of networking opportunities, where you have your breakfast, your lunch, then we'll have cocktails, and then dinner. And, you know, usually that, it's all geared to keep the group together, whether it's a ballroom where we'll have a performer, and then we'll have the massage chairs.
Because, you know, everybody's sore at the end of the day.
Yes, so it is an intense day. But, you know, but this way we want to foster that networking. Or we'll do an offsite at like a bowling alley or Topgolf or, you know, someplace like that. But the key is, on both sides, you know, sure, the suppliers love the opportunity to network with the buyers during these functions, especially the buyers they may not have met with or that they met with and they want to further the conversation. But the buyers want to meet and network with other buyers because they compare notes.
Yes.
They all, you know, they'll bounce ideas off of each other, you know, and they'll get a lot of good intelligence on the category from each other. And I always say, you know, the best source of information is your peers, you know, just get everybody together. So I'm a big fan of roundtables.
Yeah. And that's the thing that you don't realize unless you've been on the other side of it, is that as a buyer, you don't have a lot of time to do the research in your market category necessary. You actually rely a lot on your suppliers providing that information,
yeah.
But you know, it's a salesy pitch when you hear it from them. So you've got to find another way to like vet that and like talk to other buyers, because actually, you know, it's a really, everybody knows each other. And uh-huh. So, you know, I've been in and around office furniture for really like that was my broader yeah. category where I knew every buyer in every store.
Okay.
And because I was an outside consultant, it was like they would call me and they would say, hey, what are you hearing about materials? Are you hearing darker woods are in? Like they would, you know, and they would ask me that because they knew I was touching other stores. And so it was their way of getting out, what are the other stores doing? And so they want that info. They just don't have a lot of opportunity to get it.
Well, it's funny, I use that and just the sheer number of people that are at our sessions to actually crowdsource insights from them. So during each of our sessions, we have what we call exit interviews, where a member of our staff meets with each attendee for a 20-minute meeting to get feedback on what we can improve. You know, so, and yeah, so we're talking, you know, there's dozens of these meetings every session, and we act on them. We have a meeting at the end of the session where we get all that feedback, and we say, how can we make this better? Whether it involves tech, whether it involves a process thing, or a people, a service thing. And so we're constantly doing that, and that's why we've evolved the way we have. And the cool thing is, I would insert a question in there, and I inserted it for buyers because, you know, suppliers are also, like you said, they're going to answer in the way that best suits them. But so I put in a question so I could crowdsource insights. So Mike, the question is, you know, what product blew you away and why? Mm. Because in the answer to that question, I'll get kind of the trend that's happening. So for example,
you'll start to see it happen from exit interview to exit interview.
And one retailer would say, you know, I loved these, you know, this grab and go thing because it was vegan and convenient, you know? And so you'll see, okay, you know, obviously
veganism is a trend going on, right? Yeah.
Plant-based, yeah, not me, but plant-based is a big trend. Portability is a trend, on the go, you know, so we can, you get a dozen or two dozen answers on those questions, and it gives me a good idea of where to go with my content, you know, and that's where I come in is, you know, my role with ECRM is twofold. One is to create content that keeps our current customers engaged with us throughout the year.
And that's on both sides, on the buyer side and the supplier side.
When we say customer, we talk about the retailers, food service operators, and the suppliers. So to keep them engaged with us in between the in-person meetings. You know, I mean, at the in-person meetings, we do have content there. But also in between to keep, you know, just to keep them, keep us on their radar. But then obviously also to help kind of draw new potential customers into the fold by just letting people know that we're here because, you know, the industry's so big and, you know, you get some of these startups that they come out of nowhere and they're not necessarily gonna know who we are right off the bat until they start getting out there. So I've seen so many instances, especially on LinkedIn, because we're B2B, so LinkedIn's our primary social media platform, but we'll see somebody coming in saying that I may have connected with saying, hey, I didn't know you guys were affiliated with RangeMe, you know, tell us more about what you guys do, you know. So yeah. We're getting people coming in from there or from our content floating around. And the cool thing is, since we have so much staff that's dedicated to these categories, our staff almost acts as micro-influencers within their domain. So they're posting their own content.
Health and beauty and toy and whatever experience they have. That's really fabulous. So, you know, that's something here is that, you know, I'm going to close with that because I think that's really awesome. So product launchers, I really want you to pay attention to Joe's profile because on Joe's profile are links to that. Make sure you friend him on LinkedIn. I know because I know that's where he posts the best information.
Follow him there, right?
Yeah. And friend him there because you're going to be able to keep up on all of that. The other thing that I want to make sure that we do, and I will do that as a follow-up with this, is get, you mentioned 6 trade publications. I want to put them in this blog post here and make sure that we have links to all 6 of those because one of the things that I talk about in other episodes many times is that, you know, I call it, you know, the trifecta. And one of the things is to get good coverage in a trade publications that a buyer actually cares about. And because you have, you know, so much connection with buyers, I guarantee you probably one of these 6 trade publications they probably read. And well, so you know, that's a good place for it.
Yeah, that's something that I'd like to talk to your audience about in future sessions is the content side of this, how to leverage LinkedIn to get your product out there, to get noticed, how to create content within, you know, guest columns, how to get a guest column accepted by a trade media editor, you know, things that they could do, different ways that they can get involved to make themselves into an expert. You know, I've had people that they're experts. They have 40 years in a retail company, but they're afraid to voice their opinion in a column. And I'm like, wait a minute. There are not many people around that know that business better than you.
This is how I ended up with a column, right? Because there weren't many people out there. They're out there looking for that, right?
So I definitely love to make myself available for your audience for anything content related, anything, if they have questions. I've sat in on hundreds and hundreds of meetings with buyers and sellers at our sessions. So I've seen great ones. I've seen bad ones. I can give you some advice on how to avoid some of the making it a bad one. And so anything like that, I would love to help you guys with.
Okay, guys. So product launchers, make sure you tune in to Joe's next office hours, which will be coming up in the, within 30 days. Every expert's going to do it one a month. So you'll be finding him there. And you can also reach out to him through the profile at any time. All his contact information is there. Remember, we're not gating anyone here. We want to make sure you have direct contacts to these experts because they want to help you. They want to help you grow. They want to help you avoid the hazards of product launching, the really dangerous ones. And they want to help guide you into the things that you don't know that you don't know yet. So thanks, Joe, for joining us as an expert. And we look forward to more office hours with you.
Look forward to working with everybody.